Yeah, let's go to the next speaker. It is Pritam Ganguly from IIAC. So he will talk about the theorem of Chernoff for quasi-analytic functions. Pritam. You can start, I think. Full screen.
Okay, shall I start?
Yeah, start.
Okay, so first of all, I want to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to speak here. So my talk will be on a theorem of Chernoff for quasi-analytic functions. The main aim of this talk is to give you a flavor of Chernoff type theorem in different spaces and recent progress and open problems in this direction. So we'll start with the word answer quasi-analyticity. So we all know that the key property of an analytic function is that it is completely determined by the values of the function and its derivative at a single point, which is actually clear from the Taylor series expansion of an analytic function on R. Borel first observed that there is a large class of smooth functions, like larger than the analytic functions, which has this magnificent property of being determined by the values of the function and its derivative at a single point. And he coined the term quasi-analytic for such class of functions. Now, let us first formally define this class of function. So the definition is, if subset of a class of smooth function is said to be quasi-analytic, if for any member of that class, all the derivatives vanish at a single point, then that will imply f is zero. So this is the definition of quasi-analytic class of functions. So now the natural question is how to find this kind of class. So in order to do that, we will first start with the analytic function. So from the definition, it is obviously clear that analytic functions are also quasi-analytic. Now, if we look at the analytic function, it is an easy exercise to show that a function is analytic if and only if the L infinity norm of the derivatives of the function, nth derivative of the function, the growth of that is controlled by n factorial times a to the power n. A is some constant depending on the function. Now, since we are demanding quasi-analyticity, which is less than analyticity, so we can allow more growth here. It is natural to expect to allow more growth here. So it is natural to ask whether relaxing the growth condition on the derivatives generates quasi-analytic class or not. In 1912, Hadamard proposed the problem of finding sequences of positive number such that the class CMN, which is defined to be the set of all smooth functions for which the growth of the L infinity norm of the nth derivative is controlled by AF to the power n times this sequence MN. So Hadamard proposed the problem of finding such sequence for which CMN is a quasi-analytic class. So in 1921, Denjoy gave a partial answer to this question, and later in 1926, Carleman completed the answer. And now this question is completely answered by a theorem which is popularly known as Denjoy-Carleman theorem. So which states that the class CMN is quasi-analytic class if and only if this series is divergent. So the nth term of the series is just from that numbers mn to the power minus 1 by n. So now once we have this criteria of this necessary and sufficient criteria to be quasi-analytic class, we can find examples. For example, if I take mn to be n factorial, then this class actually corresponds to an analytic function, and one can check that this Denjoy-Carleman condition is satisfied, and hence this is a quasi-analytic class. Also, one can take mn to be log n to the power n or log n to the power n times log n to the power n, and one can go on like this. And this will give quasi-analytic class which are not analytic, not merely analytic. And these examples are first pointed out by Denjoy. Now it's natural to ask whether such theorems can be proved in a higher dimension space or not. So in 1939, Bochner and Taylor proved the generalization of Denjoy-Carleman theorem on Rn. So to state that theorem, I need some notations. So given a smooth function on Rn, let us denote the mod of fx by d naught fx, and dk fx is the kth partial derivative, kth multi derivative, and we take the sum over mod alpha equals to k, where mod alpha is basically the sum of the indices alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n, and we take sort of a little l2 norm pointwise. Now, using these notations, Bochner and Taylor theorem reads as follows. So they proved if f is a smooth function defined on a connected domain and x naught be an interior point, then there are two conditions. If dk fx is controlled by mk for every x in that domain and mk satisfies this condition, the series is divergent, and dk fx and dk f of x naught is zero for every k, then f is identically zero. So you can note that dk f of x naught is zero for every k essentially means all the partial derivatives vanish at a single point x naught. So this is sort of gives a quasi-analytic class on Rn. Later, Chernoff revisited these quasi-analytic functions, study of this, Chernoff started the study of this quasi-analytic function, and instead of considering all the partial derivatives, he considers only Laplacian and proved a sufficient condition for a smooth function to be quasi-analytic. So his theorem is this, which states that if function is, suppose f is a smooth function and delta be the standard Laplacian on Rn, assume that all the powers of the Laplacian applied to f is in L2, and this satisfies this condition, this sequence, this series is divergent. We will often call this condition is a Carleman condition for the Laplacian, the associated operator. If this is satisfied, then if f and all its partial derivatives vanish at a single point x naught, then f is identically zero. So this theorem actually tells you how a partial differential operator, for example, Laplacian, generates a class of quasi-analytic functions. Now, because of this, the beautiful nature of this theorem forces us to ask the following questions. So what happens if we replace the Laplacian by any other second order differential operator? Also, Rn is a Riemannian symmetric space. Rn is a flat Riemannian symmetric space. So one can also ask whether analog of this result true for the Laplace-Beltrami operator on Riemannian symmetric spaces of both compact and non-compact type. And also the non-commutative neighbor of Rn in the is the Heisenberg group. So it is natural to ask whether such result is true for sub-Laplacian. Even if we So far we have only considered the vanishing condition is like f and all its partial derivatives vanish at a single point. Now, another question is, even if we replace the vanishing condition by a stronger one, that is, for example, if I assume that the function vanishes on an open set, can we arrive at the similar conclusion in the setting of symmetric spaces and different Lie groups? So this kind of questions we have in mind. And then why it is important? Because suppose if we can prove the result with the stronger condition, then that also provides a class of function which is actually determined by its values on a small region. We don't have to look for its values everywhere. So that's why it is very interesting. And the rest, in the rest of the talk, we will try to describe all the available answers to these questions so far. So we'll start with the Riemannian symmetric spaces of non-compact type. So let me quickly review the setting. So let G be a connected non-compact semisimple Lie group with finite center and K be a maximal compact subgroup. And X equals to G mod K or G by K with the associated Riemannian symmetric space. And it is well known that this is a non-compact Riemannian manifold. So for example, one can have in mind the setting of SL2R. SL2R is a non-compact semisimple Lie group, and maximal compact subgroup inside SL2R is SO2, the special orthogonal group of order 2. And the associated symmetric space is SL2R by SO2 is basically the upper half space. So let this German G and German K denote the Lie algebras of the Lie group G and K. Then the Cartan decomposition of this Lie algebra reads as is given by the direct sum of this German G and German P. P is some subspace. Now, if we fix a Now fix a maximal abelian subspace A of P, small a of P. So, and the dimension of A is called the rank of the symmetric space. Now, capital A, we denote capital A we denote exponential of A by capital A. Exponential is basically the usual exponential map from the Lie algebra to the Lie group. And let M denote the centralizer of A in K. Now using this notation, the Iwasawa decomposition of the semisimple Lie group reads as G equals to KAN, where K is K and A we have already explained, and N is nilpotent. N is a nilpotent Lie group. In fact, this G and KAN, there is a diffeomorphism. This is a diffeomorphism, but it may not be a group, may not be a group homomorphism. And since it's X is a Riemannian manifold, so there is an associated Laplace-Beltrami operator, we will denote this by delta X. So we want to look for Chernoff type theorem for this delta X. So in 2020, Bhoumik, Pusti and Ray initiated the study of the Chernoff type theorem on Riemannian symmetric spaces, and they proved this result. So they proved if X is a Riemannian symmetric spaces of non-compact type, and F is a smooth function such that all the powers of the Laplace-Beltrami operator applied to F is in L2, and this operator satisfies this Kerr-Lehmann condition, then if F vanishes on a non-empty open set, then F is identically zero. So here one can see that the vanishing condition is much stronger. So the result is weaker, but still interesting, because still we can have a class of function which is completely determined by its values on a smaller region. Now it is natural to ask whether we can replace this stronger vanishing condition by a weaker one, that is vanishes all the derivatives at a single point. Then also we need to know what the derivative means in symmetric spaces and all that. So to state that, we need two definitions. So first of all, we know that X is so the Riemannian symmetric space is given by G by K. So any function on the Riemannian symmetric space, we can think of this function as a right K invariant function on the associated semisimple Lie group. And we also say that a function on the Lie group is K by invariant if the function is invariant with respect to the action of K from both left and right side. This is the definition. And let D of G by K denote the algebra of differential operators on G by K, which are invariant under the left action of G. Now, with these things, this same group recently proved a result which states that if X is a G by K Riemannian symmetric space of non-compact type, and if it is a smooth function, be a left invariant. F is a smooth function which is a left K invariant. That is, F is a K by invariant function on the semisimple Lie group. And this condition and this Kerr-Lehmann condition is there. Then they are able to prove that if all the for every D from the algebra DG by K applied to F vanishes at a single point, then F is zero. So this is sort of the exact analog of Chernoff theorem for the Riemann restriction. Is the result is true for a very small class of function. This is only true for the K by invariant functions, but there is no restriction on the rank of the space. So recently we visited this Riemannian symmetric spaces of non-compact type case, and we got a result. So to describe our result, we need some notations. So the Iwasawa decomposition on the Lie algebra side reads as the German G is decomposed as this. This is direct sum of German K, German A, and small n. And for our result, we will assume that the rank of X is 1. That is, the dimension of this vector space A is 1. Since the dimension is 1, let us fix a basis H. Let us call a basis H to be a basis of this A. And we know that every element of the Lie algebra give rise to a left invariant vector field on the Lie group. So similarly, H will give rise to a left invariant vector field on the Lie group. And by an abuse of notation, we will denote the both the thing denote both the thing by same age. So this is actually defined by this prescription. You take f of g dot exponential of th, and then take the derivative ddt and take evaluate it at t equals to zero. Likewise, we can define all the powers of h. Just we take powers of ddt. So with these vector fields, we have an analog of Chernoff theorem, which states that if X is a rank one Riemannian symmetric space of non-compact type, and F is a smooth function such that all the powers of the Laplace Veltrami operator applied to F is in L2, and the operator satisfies this Carlyman condition, then if all the powers of H, all the powers of this vector field H applied to F vanish at a single point, then F is identically zero. Here one can see that there is no restriction, nor it's no extra restriction on the class of function. And why it is an analog of the Chernoff theorem? So because one can see that this H is actually a left invariant vector field, and Laplacian Laplace Veltrami operator also is a left invariant vector field. So if we assume the condition that H power L applied to F vanish on a single point, by using a translation argument, we can assume that H power L vanishes at the identity coset. And that vanishing condition is a counterpart of this Euclidean vanishing condition, that is f of r omega, apply the derivative ddr k times r equals to zero, evaluate at r equals to zero is zero, where r omega is the polar decomposition of a point in Rn. Now one can easily check that using, one can easily calculate this derivative, and the derivative turns out to be this sum over mod alpha equals to k, alpha-th partial derivative of r omega times omega to the power alpha. So these are just multi-index notation. Then if all the derivatives in this side vanish at a zero for every k, if and only if all the partial derivatives of f vanish at zero. So in this sense, this is actually an exact analog of rank-on symmetric, analog of Chernoff theorem for the Laplace Veltrami operator on the rank on symmetric space. And also the semi-simple beauty of these spaces, and semi-simple beauty of these spaces, and using the Iwasawa decomposition, one can prove that vanishing of these vector fields coming from the A part actually implies that all the vector fields vanish at X naught. So this can be checked. But still, we don't have any answer for the Chernoff theorem on the Riemannian symmetric space without any restriction on rank. So this is still an open problem. Now, once we are done with the non-compact case, now let's move to the compact Riemannian symmetric space case. So the setting is follows. Setting is the following. If g comma k be a compact symmetric pair, and let S equals to g by k be a associated symmetric space. So in fact, we can take G to be a compact semisimple Lie group, and K is its closed subgroup. We assume that X has rank one, and then G will have a Cartan decomposition, KAK, where K can be identified with some interval. For example, under certain normalization, we can assume R to be pi. We don't need it here right now. Later, H.C. Wang completely classified the rank one compact symmetric spaces, and he proved that any rank on symmetric space is one of either it's a sphere or it's a projective space of this kind. Either it's a real projective space, complex projective space, quaternionic projective space, or is a Cauchy projective space or Kelly space, Kelly plane. So using this decomposition, we can have explicit expressions of eigenvalues of the Laplace Veltrami operator, which are very helpful in our study. And using those things, we are able to prove, we could prove a result for Chernoff type result for the Laplace Veltrami operator in the rank one case, which states this: if F is a smooth function such that again all the Laplace powers of the Laplace Veltrami operator applied to F is in L2, and this operator satisfies this Carlyman condition, then F cannot vanish on an open set, any open set, unless it is identically zero. So here is our theorem is with the stronger vanishing condition. So it's natural to ask whether we can replace this vanishing condition and get a theorem, and what would be an analog of this kind of theorem for the rank one kids, for higher rank kids.
Can I interrupt for a minute?
Yes, yes.
Actually, this is a very nice condition, right? I mean, when you say stronger vanishing condition, in some of the previous results, I might be mixing up two different things, but in the results by Pushti Rai and I forget the third author.
This one.
Yeah. Oh, it is just the function. Okay. It's not the function and the Laplacians. It's only the function.
Only the function vanishes at us on the open set.
I see. All right. Okay. 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 Then, yeah, then it is definitely stronger. Okay. Yeah. Thanks. Okay. The reason I interrupted is because I misremembered the result and I thought you already have a weaker condition than they do. Okay. Oh, my mistake.
Okay.
Carry on.
So moving on. So our result is with the stronger vanishing condition. So it's natural to ask whether we can replace the stronger vanishing condition by a weaker one, and also whether we can prove similar result on the higher rank case. So recently, again, the same group, Bhoumik, Pusti and Ray, revisited the compact symmetric space case for the, they considered the higher rank compact symmetric spaces, and they proved that if S is a Riemannian symmetric space of compact type, there is no restriction on the rank, and F is a smooth function which is K invariant. That is, again, we are considering only the K bi-invariant functions on the Lie group. And if we assume that the Kerlemann condition holds, then they proved that if I take D from the differential algebra of the differential operators on this compact symmetric space, which are invariant under the left axon of the group, if all the differential operator, such differential operator applied to F vanish at the identity coset, then F is identically zero. So here the conditions are much, much strong, because first of all, they are considering, although they are not assuming that the function vanishes on an open set, they are considering the function is smooth and the function is K bi-invariant, and the vanishing condition is on the identity coset, not on any other point. So also the above theorem cannot be deduced from this theorem, because the above theorem, the vanishing condition is on any open set. So recently we have also revisited this compact symmetric space case, where we dealt with only the rank one case, and we are able to prove a natural analog, exact analog of Chernoff theorem. So to describe that result, I need to introduce the polar coordinates on compact symmetric space. So each compact symmetric space actually admits the appropriate polar coordinate, theta xi, where theta is coming from 0, pi, and xi is coming from unit sphere. The dimension of the unit sphere depends on the associated symmetric space. And in these polar coordinates, the Laplace-Beltrami operator looks like this, sum of two operators, where this, the first operator is basically the real part, which is given by some Jacobi operator of type alpha beta. Alpha beta is associated to the symmetric space, minus rho s of theta is a sum function of theta. And this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the sphere. So one can, you have in mind the example of sphere. So in sphere, if I take any point, I can write this point in terms of the standard basis of RQ plus one. So I can write this as this. Now using this, and we know that these coefficients are unique since it's a basis, since U1, E2, E, dot, 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 UQ plus EQ plus one is a basis. We can, this induces a map from 0, pi cross sq minus 1 to sq. The map is defined by these coefficients. So this actually induces the polar coordinate system on the sphere. And this actually also says how a sphere can be thought of as 0, pi cross sq and a lower dimensional sphere. So now, once we have this polar coordinate system, now if we recall, now the vanishing condition for the Euclidean case in polar coordinate system, also the Laplace-Beltrami operator for the sphere in this polar coordinate system will look like this, where the first part is this L alpha beta part. So this is a Jacobi operator, and rho theta is sine 1 by sine square theta, and then the remaining is the Laplace-Beltrami operator on the lower dimensional sphere. So once we have this, we have to talk about the vanishing condition, what would be the natural analog of the vanishing condition in the compact symmetric space case. So now recall that on Rn, we have these polar coordinates, 0, infinity, cross Sn minus 1. And we have already mentioned that the vanishing of all the partial derivatives at 0 is equivalent to considering the function on the polar coordinates and then take the radial derivative at 0. So now if I see, so for the compact symmetric space case, only rank 1, the same polar form, that we have an analog of polar form, 0 pi comma the sphere. And every function on the symmetric space S corresponds to another function capital F on the polar form. So in view of this vanishing condition on the Euclidean space, natural vanishing condition on the compact symmetric space will be this. Consider the corresponding function capital F and take the derivative in the theta variable. So using this vanishing condition, recently we could prove a result, which is a joint work with Ramesh Manna and Isthankavilu sir. So we proved if S is a rank 1 Riemannian symmetric space of of compact type, and let S is a smooth function such that all the derivatives, all the powers of the Laplace-Beltrami operator applied to F is in L2, and it satisfies the Carl-Lehmann condition, then if the corresponding function on the polar form satisfies this vanishing condition, then F is identically 0. And this actually completes the rank 1, settled the rank 1 case, because since these are translation invariant operators, delta S, so vanishing at a single point, we can assume, using a translation argument, we can assume that vanishes at the identity quotient. But still, the higher rank case, the exact analog for the higher rank case is still open. Now, once we are done with this symmetric space business, let us move to a non-commutative neighbor of Euclidean space, which is the Heisenberg group. So Heisenberg group is basically defined as Cn cross R. The group law is defined by this, where in the first variable, this is just the addition. And in the second variable, along with the addition, there is a twisting term, which is basically a symplectic form on R2n, and which actually makes this group a non-commutative group. And we know that this is a simplest example of a step two nilpotent Lie group, where the Lebesgue measure dz dt plays the role of Haar measure. The Lie algebra, which consists of the left invariant vector fields on the Lie group, on the Heisenberg group, has the basis consisting of 2n plus 1 vector fields. The vector fields are given by this, xj, yj, and t corresponds to the central variable. So using these vector fields, we can define the sublaplacian. The sublaplacian is defined as the sum of squares of the first 2n vector fields. That's why it's called sublaplacian, and which can be explicitly calculated. And the form will be this. So one can check that this is not an elliptic operator, but it so we in 2020 we could prove a weaker result for the Scherfer's weaker result relating to regarding the Chernoff theorem for the sublaplacian. So in a joint work with Bakshi, Sarkar, and Thangavelu, we proved that if F is a smooth function such that it depends on this norm only, that is, this norm is known as the Korani norm on the Heisenberg group. So Korani norm is basically a homogeneous norm, homogeneous with respect to Heisenberg dilation. So basically, we are considering the smooth functions which are Korani radial. And if we assume that all the powers of the sublaplacian applied to F is in L2, and it satisfies the Carl-Lehmann condition, then if F and all its partial derivatives vanish at 0, then F is identically 0. So here we have two much stronger conditions. One is we had to take the radial functions, Korani radial functions only, and the vanishing at a single point, but it is only 0. The non-zero case is still not known. But recently, we consider the full Laplacian. Full Laplacian on the Heisenberg group is given by this, along with the sub-Laplacian. We consider also the central vector field, square of the central vector field. You sort the full Laplacian, we have a better result. So we could prove that if F is a smooth function on the Heisenberg group such that the full parts of full Laplacian applied to F is in L2 and it satisfies the Carlyman condition, then if F vanishes on a non-empty open set, then F is identically zero. So again, the theorem is with the stronger vanishing condition. So now the two close relatives of sub-Laplacian are the Hermite and special Hermite operators. They are connected to sub-Laplacian via these relations. So if I take a function on Cn and multiply by e to the power it and now apply sub-Laplacian, so the e to the power it part will come out. And whatever is left, that is called the special Hermite operator, which is explicitly given by this. And if I take the Weyl transform of the special Hermite operator applied to F, that will give us the Hermite operator here. So I haven't defined Weyl transform though. So it's just for the information. And both of these operators are elliptic differential operators. And we have a Chernoff type theorem for both of these operators. I will just state it in one go. So if F is a smooth function on either on Cn or Rn, such that all the parts of these operators applied to F is in L2 space, and that operator satisfies this Carlyman condition, then F cannot vanish on any open set unless it is identically zero. So this is sort of class of functions on Cn or Rn, which is completely determined by its values on a small region. So I will end this talk with some open problems in this direction and one application of this kind of theorems. So analog of Chernoff theorem for the sub-Laplacian with a stronger vanishing condition. We only have the result for the sub-Laplacian. We have to assume the function to be Courant irradial. So using the strong vanishing condition, whether we can get the full result for the full class of function or not, that's still open. Also, exact analog of Chernoff theorem for the sub-Laplacian or the full Laplacian with the weaker vanishing condition, that is all the vector fields applied to F vanish at a single point where this x power alpha stands for this multi-index notation. Likewise, we can define y power beta and t power m. Also, what would be the exact analog of Chernoff theorem for the Hermite and special Hermite operator with this kind of vanishing condition, that is vanish at a single point, all the partial derivative vanish at a single point. So recently for x naught equals to zero, we have proved this result for Hermite and special Hermite operator, and for x naught non-zero, the case is still open. Also, the theorem with this stronger vanishing condition, that is vanishing on an open set, this open set case has been very useful to prove certain qualitative uncertainty principle. So in fact, one can use Chernoff type theorem to prove sharp decay for the spectral projections of the operator, spectral projection associated to the operator of the functions which are allowed to vanish on an open set. In fact, spectral projection of the function can have any decay we want, but this is not the case if we assume the function to vanish on an open set. So this kind of theorems can give answer to those questions. Also, one can prove sharp decay of the Fourier transform of functions which vanishes on an open set. So this kind of results are there. So these are the references. So this is the classical paper of Chernoff, and these are our results. Also, in every paper, one can find the applications of the Chernoff theorem as this uncertainty principles of INCAM is proved as an application of Chernoff theorem. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. Are there some questions?
Yeah, I have one question.
Yes.
Hi, this is Gautam.
Yes, sir.
I'll only ask about the Riemannian symmetric spaces of non-compact type. My geometric intuition does not extend very easily beyond that class. Okay, so like when I was listening to you, it occurred to me probably there is a conception that, there should be a conceptual reason why, if you don't put a constraint on the rank, you don't assume rank one. And you want to generalize a Chernoff type result by positing that Laplacians of all orders vanish at a point, not that the function vanishes on a non-empty set, but vanishing on a point. Likewise, if you consider a Riemannian symmetric space of non-compact type, and you want to, you have only a pointwise vanishing condition, but now you want to generalize to all ranks. I suspect there's a conceptual reason why things become very messy going beyond either of these two different kinds of constraints.
Yes.
What is that conceptual reason actually?
So the main reason is, if you look at the rank one case, and using the, there is a Cartan decomposition for the rank one case, Ka plus K. So they are K by invariant functions actually coincides with the radial functions on the Riemannian symmetric space.
Oh,
I see. It coincides with the radial function, then we can look at the Rn case, and there you can see f of r omega, r is that exactly the radial variable. That's why this kind of conditions are vanishing conditions, that's natural. But for the higher rank case, there is no such things. K by invariant function doesn't coincide with the radial functions. They are different. And also for the rank one case, d g by k, that is the differential operators on the Riemannian symmetric space, which are k invariant and left and g invariant with respect to the left axon, they are only given by the they are only generated by the Laplace-Beltrami operator for the rank one case. And vanishing condition, if we assume only for assume with respect to the Laplace-Beltrami operator, the result is not true. That is, for that we have examples. If I only assume that the powers of Laplace-Beltrami operator vanish at a single point, then the result is not true. Even for Rn, it is not true. Also for Riemannian symmetric space, it is not true.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Right. Let's see. Yeah, that is absolutely right. Meaning to say, even when you stick the Kalman condition in, even then you are out of luck, eh? I mean, obviously, if you don't stick the Kalman condition in and you take a function, you, it's very easy to write down examples of functions where all the iterated Laplacians, evaluation under of the iterated Laplacians is zero, the function is still not identically zero. But you are saying you have examples even when you stick the Kalman condition in, yeah?
Yeah, that's true.
Okay, excellent. And
in fact, for R, the example is very easy. X times e to the power minus x square by 2. X times the Gaussian for R. But for Riemannian symmetric space, rank on Riemannian symmetric space, we have examples on the hyperbolic spaces. That example requires the knowledge of analogs of spherical harmonics on these spaces.
Okay.
So that is quite non-trivial.
Right, okay. So yeah, so there is a conceptual obstacle. So now I was wondering, if one wants to weaken the condition of vanishing on a non-empty open set, there are conceptual difficulties to giving the right condition for what the pointwise vanishing condition is, then is there some small non-empty set with empty interior, some special set? So for instance, of course, if one is looking at complex analytic functions, these are extremely rigid functions because they satisfy an additional, they are annihilated by a family of differential operators. But in fact, for complex analytic functions, you can specify a small subset with empty interior, on which a function vanishing implies the function vanishing globally. So keeping that sort of a principle in mind, would that make sense in the Riemannian symmetric case? The Riemannian symmetric, let's keep it simple, non-compact type.
Yeah, you are muted, I think. Pritam, we can't hear you. Pritam, you have to unmute.
Ah.
No, he's muted.
Yes, let me.
Maybe Pritam, remove your microphone, the wire itself, maybe that will help. I don't know.
Yeah, Gautam, your question is asking about the analog of Wagner and Taylor's theorem.
Or Vamsi, can you unmute, Pritam?
Yeah, hello.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so actually the set you are talking about is called, there is a name, it's called a set of analytic determination.
And okay.
Already Wagner and Taylor in 1939, they considered this kind of sets and proved a result for the Laplacian on Rn and Laplacian on the sphere. They consider the L infinity norm on the powers of the Laplace Beltrami operator that is controlled by some sequence Mk. And this, if the Mk satisfies this Dendroy-Kalman type condition, then they prove if all the powers of the Laplacian only vanishes at a set which is a set of analytic determination, then the function is zero.
Okay.
So those kind of theorems still for the Riemannian symmetric space case.
Oh, so they're still not known, is it? Meaning it's...
Yeah, they're still not known.
Oh, how interesting. Okay.
No, probably it is not considered, but the Riemannian symmetric spaces, it should not be difficult to prove.
I was wondering, yes.
I mean, he uses heat kernel techniques, just the one-dimensional case.
Right. I mean, as soon as you said Wagner-Taylor, I realized that this uses... these are one-dimensional... methods. Okay, so probably not consider, that's what's happened. Okay, thank you.
Maybe it's time to stop. I think we have a coffee break. All of us are welcome. I mean, not to my home.